And I want to step back a little bit, quite a bit, in fact. This is what we're being in China encouraging you to do. Step back. How you shallow Americans can come here and talk about history. And so we've got 4,000 years of archives sitting out there to explore. So I'm going to step back today, not 4,000 years, but about 500 years, and talk about where we've come from and why I think the 1970s and the post-1970s period has presented us with a tectonic shift in culture and institutions that's going on. You can measure it as you like against the standards of what's been happening in Russia today. A counterpoint to explain what I think we cannot explain if we only look decade by decade or a few decades at a time. One of the problems we have in environmental history right now is everybody's trying to do contemporary history or the 20th century. And I think this is great. We're getting incredible information and details and interesting arguments and complexity. But we're perhaps losing sight of some deeper, bigger issues going on that are necessary to think about. So, I've got a lot of pictures up here, and I hope, despite jet lag, I can make these go in the right direction. A specter is haunting Earth. The specter of an end to economic race. All the national powers, big and small, rich and poor, moved into a holy alliance to exorcise this specter. Putin and Trump, Merkel and Xi Jinping, radicals and reactionaries, will they succeed or not? Those are my words. But they have been loosely borrowed from two famous German philosophers of the 19th century. You recognize them, I'm sure. They're from that famous political pamphlet of 1848, the Manifesto of the Communist Party. I'm paying homage to Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels, while at the same time I want to suggest that their single-minded focus on class struggle as the main engine of historical change was too narrow then, and it's certainly too narrow today. I want to talk about economic growth. We've been talking about pollution, health issues, to some extent water management and so forth. But in some ways, it seems to me the dominant, the big elephant in the room of the last few decades has been the question of economic growth. Economic growth originated as a gospel preached by the very class that Marx and Engels called the bourgeoisie. A gospel, however, that was enthusiastically taken up eventually by the proletariat and even by those revolutionary German scholars themselves. Today, the specter of communism is all but dead in the world. Certainly dead in China, where the 80 million members of the Communist Party today include mostly businessmen. Fancy this, each of us. And haunts the remnants of the communist world as much as the capitalist world. The specter of an end to economic growth. Bravely, a few economists are beginning to grapple with that specter. They're acknowledging a global decline in growth that has been going on for several decades, especially in the advanced industrial nations, one that may portend a general decline of growth everywhere. I've got to keep looking backwards because I can't remember what you scored in my slide. Why the decline in world economic growth rates? As you'll see, I think environmental history is obliged to address this issue and not leave it only to the economists. But the economists have got some interesting explanations and so on. Not only economists. One argument being given, of course, is that we have declining economic growth rates because there's too much state interference in business. We're hearing this from a lot of places, but certainly from Mr. Trump. Or we have a decline in economic growth because of a fall in technological innovation and productivity. There's a shift from a rural society to an industrial society is almost complete. There aren't enough people out there in the countryside anymore to go into the factories and work for low wages. and so on, and technological innovation is slowing down, etc. Or because of the weakening of demand because of excessive concentration of wealth. Those are the typical answers you'll get, I think, from the economists today. But here's one I want to suggest, that environmental stories might also be the talk about. A decline in what I call natural abundance. Not manufactured abundance, but water, clean air, soil, forest, and the Earth's ability to support a growing human population, which leads to increased cost of environmental mitigation caused by climate change, resource scarcity, pollution, etc., etc. That, to me, is another argument that ought to be out to be made. The economists are not making it very clearly in most cases. I just referenced this one book that came out about a year or so ago that has gotten a lot of attention among economists. I think it's a incredibly shallow book, but it's full of detail. The Rise and Fall of the American Economy. It starts from about 1870, and by 1970, he says, economic growth in the United States has leveled off. Level up. And we're not likely to get it back again soon because of a loss of technological innovation, which is really the sum of the British art. This was recently published in Princeton Economic History of the Western World, a very important publication series, Robert J. Gordon at Northwestern University. I think it's interesting that he ends with 1970. But why it begins in 1860 and why it ends in 1970, it's not a question this book is very skilled in answering. But let me suggest another famous economist, Nobel Prize winning economist at MIT, Robert Solow. And this is the kind of argument I think that economists are finally beginning to address. He says, I think it's perfectly possible that economic growth cannot go on at its current rate forever. What? Whoa! Whoa. Astonishing, but then he goes on to add this. There's no reason at all why capitalism cannot survive without growth or even no growth. So that's going to be an interesting historical question in the future. Would it be the same capitalism or something quite different? He doesn't address this. Another change that's going on in the field of economics is the development of environmental and ecological economics. And I would just suggest all of you in this room are in your studies of Russian and modern history, ought to be paying some attention to what these ecological economists are now doing and saying. They're a heretical group within the field of economics, but what they're doing in terms of material changes, measuring those changes, assessing them, asking their consequences and so on, opens up for us a whole new realm for theory, for ideas, etc. It's important to study the politics of environmentalism, yes, and the cultural history of these ideas, but I think we also ought to be studying the material dimensions, and these guys have a lot of interesting things to suggest. How might a broad ecological approach to economics change how we write Russia's environmental history? Or even what impact are some of these ideas about growth having in the Soviet or in Russia today? But I think at this point what we need to do as historians is to step back a long distance and ask ourselves, where does this obsession, this idea of economic growth come from? Because I think it is, again, a fundamental question that we're being faced with answering today. Now, people have written on this subject among environmentalist history. John McNeill's book, Something New Under the Sun, talks a lot about economic growth as a model, as an idea, affecting all kinds of societies in the world today. But there is no way you can answer this question if you start in 1900, as John McNeill does. Where do we start? This is the question. Well, I'm going to tell you where I would start. And you may find this wacky, but anyway, it'll be fun. Here, Duisburg, Germany. This is a drawing made of the city in the mid-16th century. And as you know, the city in northern Germany where the Rhine and the rivers come together. 500 years ago, this city was a military fortification. see that with the walls and the star battle openings at the corners of this city. This city was protecting itself with cannons against enemy forces. It was a city racked with fear. Fear of attack. Fear of change. And this is what is under attack, for the most part, a cathedral spire, just like the one down the street, towering over the city skyline, symbolizing what the elaborate fortifications defended. In 1500, the Roman Catholic Church ruled over Duisburg. The spire, the thick city walls, the gates that could be locked at night, all aimed to defend tradition, including not only religious orthodoxy, but also traditional hierarchies of intellectual and economic control over people's lives, a deference to established authority, a view of the natural world as firmly ordered by God and limited in resources and opportunities. This city would soon become the home of two of the most innovative cartographers of early modern Europe, Gerard Mercator and his son Romuald. I discovered all of this when I was at the Rachel Carson Center as a Carson Fellow in Munich a few years ago. So all of this starts basically there. The maps that father and son made of the newly discovered world to the west, produced in this fiercely defensive conservative city, would mark a profound shift in European understanding and eventually in world understanding. The Mercators were an immigrant family from Flanders, Belgium, and today, who fell into dispute with the Catholic authorities and abandoned that city for Duisburg. I don't know why they chose Duisburg, but the city would never be the same. The father, this guy, Mercator, you've heard his name many times, controversy of various sorts, was the most famous member of the family, a mathematician, an instrument maker, a friend of Copernicus, cartographer, a free thinker. He arrived in the city in 1552, already well known for having produced a new world map of the entire world. He was the first to depict the shimmering immensity of the new world, the Western Hemisphere. Making maps of that amazing hemisphere became his battering ram of change. Mercator led a rebellion against ancient theories of the heavens and the earth that go back to the Greco-Egyptian philosopher and map maker, this guy, Ptolemy, who lived from 900 to 168 AD. And I think if you go back to your schoolboy days and schoolgirl days, remember Ptolemy's views of the world as a set of nested spheres with the earth as their center. He was, for 2,000 years, the Western world's guide to the cosmos and also to planet Earth. And this is his world map. Actually, this map was printed in 1482, 10 years before Christopher Columbus. It was still being used by this point. He called it Ecumene. Note that it included only Europe, Asia, and the northern part of Africa. There's not even really any ocean there except the Indian Sea or the Indian Ocean. For at least 1,500 years, if not 2,000, the planet was understood this way, but then comes along Gerard Mercator. But it is his third son, Romuald. I don't know much about him. Nobody seems to know much about him. He created in 1587, out of data coming from voyages to the Western Hemisphere, the most striking new image of the planet. And I want to emphasize, I think when you see this map, you're seeing what we're up against since 1970s. And I'm going to come back and and make this relevant to the 1970, never fear. That's the map. There are many, many, many versions of it. You've seen it before in many versions. This is the most beautiful in the world. It sits in the National Library of Norway, created in the 1560s. It is a map, as I said, of the planet. But it's really a map of, when I looked at this, I said to myself, what is this exactly? I'd seen it many times before, but this is really a map of two planets. So I called it the two Earth or the second Earth map. A first Earth and a second Earth. The world is no longer pictured as a single Eurasian African landmass circled by a little bit of water, a river, a quench if you want. But it's a pair of spheres co-equal in size and newly joined together. It's as though a wandering body from outer space has drifted closer and closer to planet Earth, edging closer and closer until the two planets touch somewhere off the coast of Brazil. We can call this the cosmic kiss. Unmistakably, this map of the two hemispheres suggests that out in the Western Sea, the Europeans have discovered an immense quantity of untapped natural resources, fully the equivalent of another Earth. This map promises nothing less than a doubling of Earth's natural resources: forests, waters, soils, minerals, plants, animals, doubling of potential homes, and thus, in general, a huge increase in enlarged material life. And of course, he puts down on the bottom of homage to Papa, who set a noble business of making ribs. This map was produced, stolen, reproduced all over Europe, every city in Europe. Probably Regensburg had somebody drawing versions of this map. They were sold to businessmen, merchants, etc. They were put on walls, etc., etc. And finally, he put this into an atlas in 1587, which was widely distributed, not only throughout Europe, but, and I would be very interested, I know it was distributed in the Middle East. I know it made its way to China and Japan, or the Portuguese, this map. What was its effect on Russia? Certainly, somebody must have seen it, and so on. With this map, I want to suggest, modern history begins. That's a dramatic statement, but of course it begins with Columbus and the voyages of discovery. But it is with this map that I think people begin to visualize what is actually happening to their world. Nobody knew at the time this map came much about the interiors of those of that whole hemisphere, the second Earth, the second planet Earth. They didn't know anything about the interiors, soils, the variety of animals roaming across the Americas, its rich plant life, how fertile this land was, etc. They were in no position to judge how these two joined together as one planet would compare to Mercury, Venus, etc. Every report they got told of people living in the Americas, though the total number of inhabitants people could only speculate about. In fact, we're still speculating basically today because we have no census. Much has been written on the invaded people of the Americas, but they're not my focus right now. Instead, I want to draw your attention to a theory of history that emerged from the discoveries following Columbus, 1492. A theory of history that's nearly been forgotten. And I want to recover it. I want to encourage some new thinking about it. And I want you to apply it to your studies in Russian history. As far as I can determine, the first iteration of this theory, or argument, or interpretation, appeared in the year 1770.
Let me just go past this.
So where does the modern world begin? Historians generally, if you read the textbooks and so on, agree it began around 1500 AD. That's the common thing.
But what happened at that time that was so important?
And here historians fail to connect the dots. I have been reading world histories, early modern histories, up to here, and they don't connect the dots. They acknowledge this 1500, and then they rush on to talk about something else. Modern history begins with the discovery of the Western Hemisphere and its abundance of natural resources. This is where economic growth, as a philosophy, as a cultural idea, also seems to need to begin. So let's recover the history that we've lost. I know you think you know this, because we all think we know it, but we do not think it through, and certainly in terms of environmental history, we've not been thinking about it very much. So let's go to the year 1770. This is a defrocked French priest, Guillaume Thomas Reynaud, famous Enlightenment intellectual, friend of Diderot, leading philosoph in his own right, author of a searing indictment of the European discovery of the Americas, the conquest of the Americas. This indictment was published in 1770 in four volumes in Amsterdam, because he couldn't publish it in France. But in the very first paragraph of this four volumes is that theory. And I don't know who has paid much attention to this. Maybe scholars in France, my French colleagues here will tell me. There's a huge literature on this, but let me give you my, Michel, you'll forgive me for my translation here. There has never been an event as interesting for the human species in general and for the peoples of Europe in particular as the discovery of the New World and the passage to the Indies by way of Cape Horn. Then began a revolution in commerce and the power of nations and the way of life, the industry and government of all peoples. A revolution. Not merely, however, a single revolution, the French Revolution, the American Revolution, but rather a whole chain of them. It was like a set of serial explosions, bombs going off. Boom, 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 boom. During the time stretching between Columbus and Reynaud, appeared in nearly 300 years. Many revolutions he surmised had already had gone off. But before quickly going through those revolutions, I want us to take note of later iterations of the same idea. Boy, people plagiarized this guy, including this man, Adam Smith, in The Wealth of Nations, published 6 years later, 1776. If you dig through this book, it's a long book, I know, and he has so much going on in this book. But if you get about two-thirds of the way through, you'll find buried in a paragraph this sentence. It's almost verbatim from Reynaud. The discovery of America and the passage of the East Indies with the Cape of Good Hope are the two greatest and most important events in the history of mankind. Nothing about the baby Jesus. You know, this is an astonishing statement. I don't think Adam Smith knew what to do with it. He just read right now, and so he puts it into his book as well. But let me give you another example. I mentioned the Manifesto of the Communist Party, 1848. Karl Marx, on the very first page of that manifesto, they basically plagiarize again. I translated to the bottom. Again, with apologies. The discovery of America, the rounding of the Cape, gave fresh ground for the rising bourgeoisie, gave to commerce, to navigation, and industry an impulse never before known, and thereby to the revolutionary elements in the tottering feudal society a rapid development. You would think this would have something to say later on in communist ideology, but it's forgotten. That's the phrase they use, a new terrain. A new terrain. The greatest power in history, all three of these people are saying, has been the material power of nature and natural resources, and we might add climate, reproduction, tectonic forces, to change dramatically the human condition. After 1492, it was the power of natural abundance that touched off a 500-year-old transformation of economics, technologies, societies, and cultures. The revolutionary element is far more complex and multifaceted than Marx and Engels fully understood. There were, in fact, five revolutions that followed Columbus. We could sum them all and call them the modern revolutions, David Christian does in his Maps of Time book. I think it's important to sort of tease them out. Let's go through right now. He calls it the commercial revolution back in 1770, the capitalist, or we could say the bourgeois revolution. Seems to me impossible to understand where this comes from without understanding in the context of material change on planet Earth. Decline of ancient moral economy, its emphasis on communitarian values. I'm going to go through most of this very quickly because this is a long way from what you're interested in here today. Reinhold mentions as the second revolution, changes in the international balance of wealth and power, basically tilting Earth towards Europe, away from Asia. You can go find at least this thing, this part discussed now and then today in Kenneth Lomerance's work. For example, the Great Divergence. And thirdly, Reinhold talks about political revolution, new ideas of liberty, democracy, and the nation state. He's writing in 1770, of course, the American Revolution, the Haitian Revolution, the French Revolution followed. There are two that Reinhold left out, and it's going to take me 20 more years, and I'm probably not going to make it because I'm 76, but I think it will be important to try to tease things out. What it should have been, the scientific revolution. A shift away from traditional knowledge and an emphasis on exploration and discovery, etc. Just as an example of how we can begin to make these connections, I use this book from David Bloom, The Invention of Science, and the History of the Scientific Revolution, which says, before Columbus discovered America in 1492, there was no clear cut. Well-established idea of discovery, the idea of discovery is the precondition for the invention of science. And then finally, the most complicated and difficult one that nobody seems to have drawn the dots here. Almost everybody, particularly economic historians who writes about industrialization, the Industrial Revolution, talks about it only within the internal, cultural, and institutional framework of Europe, of England, the Netherlands, etc., etc. And I think we can begin to draw connections between the incredible change of the human material condition in 1492 and the Industrial Revolution. It takes a time. It takes time to adjust. It takes time for ideas and so on. But basically, new machines furnished by the capital earned from the New World, plantations in the Americas, furnishing models of work organization, raw materials for European factories, the enslavement of Africans as labor basis of this new economy until the invention of fossil fuels makes slavery unnecessary, and finally new lands in the West to absorb Europe's surplus population and provide markets for its manufacture. Karl Marx and Engels got much of this right, I think, even though they didn't know how to fit it into their books some years later. Cotton, for example. It's impossible to understand the Industrial Revolution without understanding the importance of cotton. And where does the cotton come from? Sam Burke has written an enormous bankrupt-winning bright book on cotton, but he never mentions where it comes from, really, the cotton that made the revolution. Read Ed Russell's book, recent book, and he discusses this in more detail. Cotton came from the New World. The cotton varieties that were in India and elsewhere had fibers that were too fragile. And when they began to try to mechanize weaving, spinning, and all of that stuff in the 18th century, the fibers kept breaking and breaking. They had to give up. They were trying to create a textile industry in Great Britain until somebody discovered that the cotton from the New World, nursed along by Native Americans, but a plant from the New World, had incredibly strong fibers that resisted breaking by machine, and the Industrial Revolution was off in trucks. So, you know, this is the kind of thing that I think environmental historians have to be paying some attention to. Okay, this was a very rapid go through, just to stimulate you before dinner a little bit with some thoughts and ideas. But basically what I've been talking about here is that we have, for 500 years, been living with a set of ideas and institutions organized around economic growth. Those ideas did not come out of a book. They did not come out of a group of intellectuals sitting around the table. They came from fundamental material changes and people responding to them. And I put that together, people responding to them. But what you are dealing with here in this conference is, it seems to me, in your concern about ecological modernization or globalization or whatever you want, is a change that begins after World War II. And I just want to briefly touch on this, because I think when we put it in the context of what I just said, you will see how incredibly important, and why I call this a tectonic shift going on in Western society and probably in global society from this point on. The shift in international thinking is this fundamental principle. Earth is one whole, no longer two Earths, but one Earth, and the whole has material limits. I can just give you a few quick indices of the shift that begins. Our plundered planet in 1948, right on the heels of World War II's ending. Just as the consumer society begins to explode, automobiles, housing, etc., affluence is celebrated everywhere. People write books like People of Plenty in the United States, etc., etc. This guy comes out with a book, Our Plundered Planet. That was 1948, 1962, Rachel Carson's work that had global distribution, climate spring, about persistent pesticides and the environment. And finally, this book with the remarkable title, Barbara Ward Jackson and Renee DeBose's book, written for the Stockholm Conference in 1972. So we've gone from 1948, 62, and now 1972, Only One Earth, with a picture of the photograph from outer space on the cover. I think this is a landmark series of books that express exactly what I'm talking about, a change in consciousness that we can only compare to that of Rommel Mercator's map of the 16th century. And then this book, which controversial as it has been, forgotten as it often is today, probably marks as a symptom, more than any other book of its time, one of the most neglected books of the last half century, The Limits to Growth, by two postdocs at Harvard and MIT, funded by the Volkswagen Foundation, with a team of graduate students from all over the world working on this book, published in 1972, The Limits to Growth. Economists hated this book when it came out. Politicians usually hated it. It sold, however, over 10 million copies. It is the biggest selling book with an environmental theme ever, far bigger than Rachel Carson. And this book had a global readership. I don't know what its impact was on the Soviet Union in 1972, but I think this would be an interesting question to raise in our discussion. Who was reading this book? What was the fate? What was its reception? I know in the Netherlands it changed the face of politics. It had a huge impact in that country. And all over Europe, all over the world, people were reading the book. Not because it was altogether brilliant. It was brilliantly written by Donnell Nettles, based on the data mostly assembled by a team of experts in computers and so forth. You know the arguments of it. And this is my own tattered copy of the book. It's since come out and updates, there are people who've updated the data and so on, and so on. But
I'm not so much interested in its context as I am in just
as a marker of change going on, and again, look at what this cover is. And the icons of our time, instead of maps of two Earths, the shrinking Earth. What has been the response in Russia? And we could go on from there, but I would simply suggest that since that book appeared, it was partially responsible for the rise of a whole new field of Earth ecosystem studies, the science of the Earth as a whole, made possible by computers, made possible by interdisciplinary science, made possible by huge funding grants from national governments of various sorts. Whole interdisciplinary field of science that we can call Earth science or Earth system science, which has succeeded in establishing a global agenda of research into the health, the stability, the functioning of the Earth as a unified ecosphere. And this is simply one recent illustration of what I mean here. Rockström's group, the Resilience Center in Stockholm in 2009, this article in Nature, trying to define, establish, measure planetary boundaries in so many different categories. The most dramatic and widely discussed impact is of course the global climate system, so-called threat of global warming, but others include on this list the cycling of fresh water on the planet, functioning of ecosystems in which that life is organized, the dramatic decline in global biodiversity, which points to a natural limit that we are exceeding without knowing the full consequences. But more important than these books, these articles, the research, the funding, the whole change that's going on in how science is conducted in its framework of thinking. And I think science itself has been going through a revolutionary change in thinking about its responsibilities for the Earth. Instead of an instrument of conquest, more and more concerned about the conservation at this point. And now we have stunning visual evidence of our vulnerability and limits. As stunning in their way as Ronald Mercator's map in the 16th century of two Earths was. You're familiar with all of this, I'm sure, but think again about the significance of this photograph taken by Apollo 17 in 1970, showing our home planet as a child's playground marble, resplendent in blue, white, swirling colors created by the oceans and clouds that dominate our globe. There is land in the photo too. A clear suggestion of life. The continent of Africa appears in this picture, fittingly, our home. This tawny soil, green vegetation, green forest, the birthplace of our species. But that's a kind of warm, fuzzy image that's been reproduced all over the place to make us feel differently about the planet we're on. Let me give you one more, and I think maybe even more telling about historical change. And it comes from this American spacecraft launched from Cape Florida, Cape Canaveral in Florida in 1977. In the 1970s, it looks like a big 500 kilogram insect. That white thing there, the most prominent thing in its anatomy is a dish antenna bulging out to maintain contact with its human creators. This strange creature was sent out from Earth to gather data on the planets Jupiter and Saturn. And it has continued on into interstellar space. This craft is now 20 billion kilometers from home. It's traveling at 64,000 kilometers per hour. fastest object any human has ever made, or any group of humans, to my knowledge. I said it was launched in 1977. In 1990, as Voyager 1 approached the edge of our solar system, it took pictures of what it was leaving behind. One of the cameras took this image. And I say, I'm not a prophet, but I think I can feel pretty confident that this photograph makes as important a statement of the new era as anything we have produced. Words, data, etc. I call it the pale blue dot era. Most people would not recognize what the hell this is. These color streaks are refractions from the metal skin of the insect, the spacecraft. But that's what I want you to see. The pale blue dot. Our home planet usually has to be identified by experts because few amateurs looking at it would immediately say, that's us. That's where we are in the cosmos. This is how we look from 6.5 billion kilometers away. So, in contrast to the two Earths map and the blue mark on the photograph, the Voyager photo of the pale blue dot is far less recognizable to the human mind and far more shocking to our sensibilities. It's not only a photo of where we began, but also of our limits, at least as far into the future as we can see. It tells us that the Earth is only one tiny speck in the cosmos. If we could see ourselves now from where Voyager 1 is today, the speck would completely vanish in the boundless space of 100 billion galaxies. The pale blue dot photograph that I submit will likely mark an important moment in human history. Talk about ecological globalization. We cannot know the full significance for many generations, but my conclusion is that the pale blue dot photo is already signifying the end of what we've been calling modern world history. And the beginning of a new era that will see enormous changes in almost all of our institutions, economic systems, national and international politics, and our various cultures. Indeed, to all of our understandings of who we are as human beings. And probably in the way in which we begin to write history. And when I say our writing views and understandings in Russia, as well as Western Europe, and the United States, in China, as well as in Africa, all the world's peoples have arrived more or less together at the end of the modern era, and are now facing a future that has no name. But I'll give it one just for fun. A transition from the age of the two Earths to the age of the pale blue dot. Whatever our culture or our institutions, whether we're communist or socialist or Confucians or vegetarians or Trumpites, we can see with blinding clarity one massively important fact. The Earth is only a tiny rock floating in a universe of countless rocks, big and small, great gaseous spirals gyrating over the heavens and so on. And yet for all the size and grandeur of the universe, there's no place for us humans to go but exactly where we are. Well, there's a whole literature now about space colonization. It needs to be brought into this picture, enthusiasts, comic books, Hollywood stories, and so forth. Colonizing the stars, and we're just beginning a whole new era of colonization, etc. But can that ever happen? It took Columbus a couple of months or so across the Atlantic Ocean. There was an Atlantic Ocean in concept, at least, until he did so, by the way. The discovery was not just of land masses, but of two oceans. The Atlantic and the Pacific did not exist on maps, as you see, conceptually, until people had crossed the Magellan in the 1820s, dying in Philippines. Columbus left Spain on the 3rd of August, 1492, and he sighted the Bahamas on the 12th of October. He made landfall in Cuba at the end of October. That's 2 months at sea. In terms of space travel, 2 months would not get us very far. If we could travel by the speed of light, that's 300,000 kilometers per second, 1 billion kilometers an hour, we would need more than 4 years to reach the nearest solar system, Proxima Centauri. Now, we cannot get to the next solar system in a mere 4 years because we cannot travel that fast. We cannot travel at the speed of light. We can only travel at a mere fraction of our speed. The fastest craft we've ever invented, made, launched, Voyager 1 would take, if it were aimed in the right direction, 80,000 years to reach Proxima Centauri. And if it ever arrives, it would surely be silent when it gets there. If its transmitters are still working, there's nobody to communicate with on Earth in 80,000 years. That's my prediction.
Right?
Just to put this into some perspective that the cartoon makers are ignoring, 4 light years away. If you could travel to the speed of light, you'd be able to circle the Earth's equator about 7.5 times in just 1 second. So let's get real about travel in our age and so on, and why this is so different. So, and when you get there to Proxima Centauri in 4+ years, traveling at the speed of light, what are you going to find? Will there be a planet there? I mean, like Earth, with water, air, oxygen, soil, plants and animals, etc., etc. Carl Sagan, the American scientist, probably the most widely read astronomer in the past half century, as you probably know, was a man who loved to contemplate the wonders of the universe. But even he was forced to make this admission. The Earth is the only world known so far to harbor life. There is nowhere else, at least in the near future, to which our species could migrate. Visit, yes. You know, you can build an encampment on Mars for 2 or 3 scientists and hope to get them off eventually. Settle? Not yet. Like it or not, for the moment, the Earth is where we must make our stand. So, we are up against a very different era, and I think this is going to affect all the history we write, all the ways in which we think about the past. I don't know where we're going to write and how we're going to write history in the future, but I think what we have been doing, this nation-state history that we have nourished so carefully, you know, this nation-state history, that nation-state, well, we're breaking it down a little bit into transnational history and so on, but, you know, we have not begun to reconceptualize history, we historians, and we environment historians ought to be in the lead doing this, I think. So, what will it shatter when we begin to, all of this begins to sort itself out and enter the human cosmos, seeing our true position in the universe? What will it shatter? Ideas long held and cherished, institutions that have long dominated and defined our lives, an era defined by nation states contending against each other in trade and empire, the use of the natural sciences as a weapon of conquest more than conservation, a 500-year-long period of economic growth that now even some prominent economists have joined science and humanists and historians in question and began contemplating an end in sight. So I think we are, all of us, whatever part of history, whatever decades, whatever nations, whatever, are in some sense caught up in an ecological globalization process that we may be more aware of than the people going on around us. But I think a resistance, there's also a resistance to these facts that we've got to deal with. There was resistance to Copernicus. It took 200 years for the church to acknowledge Copernicus, the truth of what he was talking about. There's going to be a long process of resistance here. And I think a resistance is already driving a lot of the politics on this planet, particularly in America, particularly on the political right. You know, make America great again. Against the context of this, that's a war cry of politics and presidents that is, it seems to me, flying in the face of history. What they mean by greatness seems to be more of freedom to build and acquire while keeping others out. So much of the tension and the anger on this planet now, and it's boiling up in ways that I was never prepared for growing up to see. The kind of anger, the politics of resentment, the fear of outsiders, foreigners coming in and taking what we have. And certainly in a country like the United States, which has this long history of immigration, it's shocking to see and think about that fear and what is touched off in our politics. What is this but in some sense people struggling to deny what they know is true? We don't live on the same planet anymore. That it's going to be much harder to be generous and share than we once thought it was possible to be. That we're going to have to refashion our institutions eventually. My hunch is, looking back historically, the change will come. Cultural change, institutional change. I don't know whether Robert Sowell's capitalism is going to survive or not. Or whether many of the things that we've cherished, political ideas, democracy, etc., industrialization as we've known, the relationship of nations to one another, and so forth, all those revolutions that I talked about in the past, that came in the wake, the modern revolution, could be shattered, could be changed dramatically, could be reformed in ways that will leave them absolutely unrecognizable to. All I know at this point is that what we are discovering is something that I think is going to take a long time to sort through and figure out. And that is simply that the universe, while infinite, is not infinite for us. Thank you.